Good evening, everyone, and welcome to what promises to be a very interesting and provocative evening. I'm Jeff Melanson, president of the Banff Center. On behalf of the 4,000 artists, the 2,000 business leaders, and 2,000 mathematicians that call this place home, welcome to the Banff Center. As some of you will know, we are the world's largest arts and creativity incubator, so we're delighted to welcome you all here tonight. What began with a performance by Wynton Marsalis continues tonight with an intimate conversation between the acclaimed director Oliver Stone and the accomplished journalist and newly appointed Banff Center Globe Canada correspondent Ian Brown. We look forward to announcing additional headline events in this series in the near future. The extraordinary generosity of Heather and Marie Edwards furthers the Center's mandate to inspire creativity and demonstrates visionary leadership. To the Edwards, our gratitude. To you, the audience, welcome to the Banff Center. And to Oliver and Ian, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Oliver Stone is, as you know, one of the most successful and prolific directors and screenwriters in the history of movies, pure and simple. He's easily the most controversial and outspoken and provocative as well. He was born in New York City in 1946 to a stockbroker father and a French mother. He made his first film in 1971 after dropping out of Yale University to enlist in the U.S. Army, where he served in the infantry in Vietnam and won the Bronze Star and a Purple Heart for being twice wounded. He turned that experience into Platoon, the classic Vietnam War movie that won a Golden Globe, a Directors Guild Award, a BAFTA Award, and two Oscars for Best Picture and Best Director. Only a handful of directors have done that. But he's probably more famous for his other, more controversial movies that always seem somehow to capture the zeitgeist. Wall Street in 1987 and its sequel, Wall Street Money Never Sleeps, 20-odd years later. Born on the 4th of July, starring Tom Cruise as a Vietnam vet. Natural Born Killers, The Doors, JFK. People are still arguing about that one. Nixon, Alexander, Savages, and of course the film we'll be watching tonight, W, A Portrait of the Presidency of George W. Bush, made and released while Mr. Bush was still in office, to name just a few of the more blistering ones. Hence Mr. Stone's reputation as a recklessly outspoken left-wing provocateur. But it doesn't stop there. He's just as revered as the award-winning screenwriter of many classics, Midnight Express, for which he won his first Oscar, Scarface, starring Al Pacino, The People versus Larry Flint, and even Conan the Barbarian. All in all, he has written, produced, and directed well over 30 movies, as well as documentaries and television shows, such as his controversial portraits of Hugo Chavez, the late president of Venezuela, and Fidel Castro, as well as the 10-part series, The Untold History of the United States, this year on Showtime On Demand, and based on a 750-page book, of which he is also the co-author. Clearly, the man is sitting down for the first time in 35 years. The films he has directed have been nominated for 31 Academy Awards, including 8 for acting, 3 for directing, 6 for screenplays. He's won 3 Oscars himself for writing, directing, and Best Picture. He currently lives in Los Angeles and New York City with his third wife of 18 years. Not 18 years old, of 18 years. We can talk about that later. He has 3 children. Ladies and gentlemen, would you give just one more warm welcome to the legendary filmmaker Oliver Stone? So welcome to Banff.
Thank you, Ian. I was going to say Gordon.
Gordon Brown. No relation at all.
But sadly. No, thank you, Ian. And it was very warm. Thank you for making me feel comfortable. But I have to live up to this, so this is going to have to be really pretty controversial.
I wouldn't normally ask for a hand of applause from an Alberta audience, given what a legendary lefty you are. But Banff is well known to have a couple of soft spots. So I think it's all right. Just before we start, we're going to watch a short clip of your collected work.
How short?
Very short.
It should be a 2-hour clip, I think.
The war. The Vietnamese don't want the war. So why does it go on?
Do you intend to cooperate with Senator Irvin's committee?
We agree to the appointment of a special prosecutor.
President?
Mr. President!
Mr. President!
President!
President! I didn't kill my father, and I don't want...
Hey! 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 I want you!
Looks like it's being accumulated. We've got a position in.
Yeah. Lou, Annika, I buy.
Dump it. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, greed is good. And greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
I'll never forget, on any given Sunday,
yes, the world is a terrible place.
It's about the game.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring. Bound by wild desire,
say hello to my little friend.
I fell into a ring of fire.
Let's go, move it. Okay, let's go.
I guess I've always been sheltered and special. I just want to be anonymous, like everybody else. Do my share for my country. Live up to what Grandpa did in the First War, and Dad did in the Second. Well, here I am, anonymous, all right. But guys nobody really cares about.
Not everybody becomes United States Marines. We want the best. We'll accept nothing but the best.
All I'm saying is I want to be treated like a human being. I fought for my country. I am a Vietnam veteran. I fought for my country.
Goodbye. No use leading without chin. This is where our story ends. Never lovers, ever friends. I wish you bluebirds in the spring to give your heart a song to sing and then a kiss. But more than this, I wish you
I want to start with a film we're going to see later tonight, W, which is your account of the life and presidency of George W. Bush. It wasn't until I watched it again recently that I remembered that you were in George Bush's class at Yale.
Yeah, that's very ironic, I think.
So he turned out to be a Republican. Was that ever a danger with you?
No, listen, you have to realize, Ian, I was born Republican. I was raised conservatively in New York City. My father was an Eisenhower Republican. He was a soldier in World War II. He believed very firmly in the Cold War, very strongly. Despised Franklin Roosevelt, despised labor unions. He was the classic American businessman. And that was the orthodoxy of my time. There was leftists, Cuba supporters in my class in school, and we would fight. And I always defended what I thought was right. I supported Goldwater in 1964. And the story goes on. I ended up in Vietnam, among other reasons, for patriotic reasons, because I wanted to fight, like the boy said, Tom Cruise in the movie, I want to do the right thing. I want to fight for my country, my grandfather, my father did. So, you know, the whole thing changed. I went through the looking glass, so to speak, in Vietnam. And I think black is white, and white is black, that syndrome starts to kick in, but not right away, and it's not radical, because I never become a protester like Ron Kovic was after the war. It took me, I was in shock, not in shock that way, but numbed out. I was trashed out, burned. And I'd seen so much disgusting things that were, as well as beautiful things, by the way. But over the years, talking to people who were more advanced than me, more evolved, consciousness-wise, and allowing women into my universe, because I'd raised mostly in a male universe, I got another perspective. And I think in the 70s, especially after Watergate and after the revelations of the Church Committee and so forth about the CIA, I definitely had turned far more to the left. However, the breakpoint, I'm going on a bit because I think this would set the tone and maybe answer a lot of your questions, but mm-hmm. The break point would have been Mr. Reagan, who I supported in his first election of 80. I didn't know much about what was going on behind the scenes, and people hated him, but in the New York City area, but I supported him. However, by the time I hit Salvador, made Salvador in 85, I had been there in 83, 84 with Boyle, and we saw Honduras, we were in Nicaragua, Guatemala, and Salvador. And those four places woke me up. Because all of a sudden I said, come on, you're almost 40 years old, and you're seeing the same thing you saw in Vietnam. You're seeing the same soldiers walking around these pink baby faces in tropical countries, in Honduras especially. And they were getting ready, no question at that time, to invade Nicaragua. That was going to be, in my belief, very strongly, Reagan would never allow the Sandinistas to control Nicaragua so close to the U.S. Never. And he fought very hard. And the Contras was a part of that plan. But the U.S. was always there in a big way. We were supporting the military in Salvador. And we were putting pressure on a huge amount of pressure. Let's get to the point. In Guatemala, it was a bloodbath. And they were all trained by us, trained, funded, and armed by us. Mm-hmm. So when I saw these things and I saw the view with my own eyes, I said, you know, this is a repeat, redux of Vietnam. And at that point, war? I made that movie, Salvador, and that was the beginning of this new path. And I think I took this path, and I think it's a progressive one. And I still learned and learned and learned, because every movie allowed me research, every mm-hmm. single one, whether it was Nixon or JFK. And now I reached this point in 2008, when we're getting around to the end here, Bush was in office. After 8 miserable years, and it was the most depressing time for me personally, having been in Vietnam, to see this mentality again, not only a dominant mentality. So to make the movie was very important, but I did not know Bush at Yale. I had met him when he was a candidate, and he had told me that he was in my class. I didn't even know much about him. And he was the kind of boy that made me flee from Yale. I say that not lightly because it's easy to make fun of Bush, but I say it also about myself because I was one of those boys, you see. I grew up, I went to a boarding school like he did, and I earned high grades, and unlike him. And I did get into Yale. I did get into Yale, part mostly on merit. But when I saw my class was this privilege, a sense of privilege, a sense of entitlement, which you still see, by the way, in the United States, in the Washington circles, in the media circles, and you see it increasingly in Hollywood circles, and certainly you see it in New York business circles. That sense of entitlement scares me and terrifies me because it is there's a fundamental corruptness about it. So I felt like I had to level the table like a carpenter might do, like I just want to get back to a smooth, clean, even surface. So by joining the volunteering for the draft, and I insisted, I said, you've got to send me to Vietnam, and I've got to go to the infantry, so don't screw around and send me to Germany or Korea or anything like that. I want a deal. So they sent me, and they sent me to the, I didn't take officer school. I wanted to go quickly because I thought the war would be over quickly. That's what everyone was saying in the United States in 67, 66, 5, in that area. I arrived on September 67, and I hit the worst part of the war, actually. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Did you always?
Which is what I wanted.
Yeah, but, what your father did not want, but what you wanted.
My father tried to get me out of it, you know, but yeah. He was the one who had told me all my life, you know, about do the right thing. I don't understand. There was a contradiction, and I think that's the contradiction of all the governing class and the politicians and the people who run our society. They, when their own children have to go to war, they're not for it. They don't want. And when they can send the poor, and they're the ones who go to the war. But when the middle class starts to get killed, as they did in Vietnam. And the college students started to turn the tide against it, as well as religious leaders, labor leaders, and protesters. There was a huge protest in this country, not in this country, in the other country. People used to come here to escape. although now I think you'd probably return them to the United States.
We welcome all comers. Did you always want to be a filmmaker?
No, I wanted to be a novelist before I went to Vietnam. And I wrote a book, which was published 30 years later, called Child's Night Dream from St. Martin's Press in 1997. I edited it some, but it's basically the writing of a 17-year-old madman who wants to break out of his cage. And I think it's interesting in a Dostoevsky kind of way.
We should have a reading.
No, I did. I used to read a lot. There's some beautiful stuff in it.
Yeah.
So. But I wanted to be. I couldn't write in Vietnam. The rain was too thick. There was no paper. Everything got wet. And towards the end of the tour, the last five months, I was in the 1st Cavalry. I got moved up from 25th Infantry to 1st Cavalry, and it was a little bit drier. And I got to. I bought a little Pentax 35, and I started taking amazing pictures. And I really loved the visual aspect of the thing. And I think the infantry experience taught me about. Combining the cerebral, which you cannot be. You cannot be cerebral and be infantry. You've got to pay attention to everything. So you have to be in the moment, which is very much like a film, you see. It becomes visceral. And I think that combination of visceral and still cerebral in some ways was a beautiful marriage for me personally after the war to go back to film school.
Now, along the way, you start writing things, you get through film school, you start making films. Can you talk briefly about co-writing Conan the Barbarian?
Yeah. No, I was one of the few students in 1960, in the class of 71. I went in 69. I didn't go right away. I had a rough period when I came back when I was, as I said, burned out, which means living in the Lower East Village, taking drugs and doing everything wrong. But I went to NYU finally. And I was one of the few kids there. They were younger than me, you realize, and I just... They were not interested in writing. It was a time of the handheld, the beginning of the experimental cinema. Just take a camera, tell the story. And I don't know, I just couldn't get there. I felt like we needed a script. And I went to screenplay class. I was about 7 students in screenplay class, which tells you that there was not much interest. But I studied liberal arts there, Greek classics, the Greek mythology, the plays. And I tried to do traditional movies. Didn't work. And then I ended up doing a very personal short film, 12 minutes, about my year in Vietnam, my life. I forgot what it was called.
Last year in Vietnam.
Last year in Vietnam. And it hit. It was a hit with the class. And this teacher was Marty Scorsese, and he loved it. So, you know, it was good, no, because it gave
Damn
me some
the bad
encouragement.
Luck, eh?
It gave me encouragement. Not that anything came easy afterward. I struggled, cab driver, messenger. You know, I tried to live in New York, and I couldn't make it in New York as a filmmaker. So I went to L.A. finally in 76, and I got some luck. But Conan was in that first batch, and I loved the book, the comic books. I loved them, and I thought they would be spectacular movies. And it's a good lesson in the movie business. I worked very hard. I wrote a $45 million at that time, $45 million movie. Today it would be about a $200 million movie. And it was so different that everyone was talking about the script, but nobody had the guts to make it. And John Milius came in and changed it. I have to say we did not agree, but he changed it, and he wrote what he wanted, and he directed it. So, but the movie could have really been a 12, could have been, in my opinion, as successful as the James Bond series. It would have made 12 movies. Dino De Laurentiis was the producer, a bad producer, a short-term producer, and he trashed, by the end of the second one, they were so bad, the second one was so bad, the first one was no great shakes, but the second one was so bad that they actually never went on with it. So he blew an asset that really could have made a fortune. When you think big and you think long term, which is what you should do, you can really, like Cameron did, you can make huge successes and have your cake too, you know?
I want to jump ahead to 1986, because in 1986, not only do you make Salvador, you make Platoon. They're both released the same year.
Yeah.
What does a director actually do? I know you don't just say, you know, emote more. I mean, it seems so completely detail conscious. I watched you come in here earlier when you were sitting down and having your mic check, and you were practically directing this show. I mean, you were sitting down. Are the lights ready? You've got, you know, the whole thing, down to the microscopic detail. And yet you bring out two huge, complicated movies in the same year. I mean, was it madness, or was it?
No, it's
just
an interesting. It's
chain?
A very good question, and I haven't been asked that a lot. If you'll indulge me, I'll just and blow my own horn a little bit, because that was out of luck, because I had been struggling to make movies since film school. That's almost 14 years. I mean, I'm stoked from the Central American trip, and I write this script in a record time, because Boyle is a living witness, and he's my partner in that. And it's got the heat of the headlines, right? Platoon has been, for me, a tragedy, because it was written 10 years before, in 76, and it had to go into the closet, because everyone loved the script, and no one wanted to make it, because it was considered a downer, too depressing, too realistic. They wanted Rambo, they wanted Chuck Norris movies, Missing in Action, Sylvester Stallone movies. They wanted the Vietnam of fantasy land, in a dangerous fantasy land. So I was very depressed about the truth ever coming out. So John Daly, an English independent, a gambler, a real street guy from East England, East London, he took a shot. He said, look, I read both scripts. Which one do you want to do first? So, you know, as a young filmmaker, this is a shot out of left field. This is beautiful. This is heaven. And I said, well, I think, if I say Platoon, I know it's going to have bad luck, because we've started it up twice and it never got made. So I'm not going to say Platoon, because I know it's over. It's not going to get made somehow. So Salvador. So we did Salvador in a record time, low budget, very low budget, and fraught with difficulties, many difficulties. It's a story unto itself. But then right afterward, John said, I want you to keep going and make another one. And you don't hear that very often, that kind of...
But, I mean, how much rest time in between?
At that point, these are my first big features. I'm not going to stop for anything. I don't think, you know, I just back to back, right from the Mexico to the Philippines, and editing rooms, and the next 10 years were a blur of activity.
Yeah. Well, you made nine movies,
Nine or ten, yeah. Because I think... You know, it was like you get your shot. You know, it's like the racehorse. You go out that gate. You don't stop, man, because they might shoot you. honestly, I was insecure, but in a good way, in the sense that I was always rushing to get the next one done. But I had something to say. I wasn't doing a movie just to experiment. I was doing it because it was a theme that I wanted to advance. But I did 10. But my biggest, most productive and most awesomely difficult year would have been 1991, because The Doors came out in 91, June, April, and JFK was done in a record time and came out in December. So those two movies are each 2.5, one's 2 hours and 20 minutes or 25 minutes, and JFK is 3 hours and 10 minutes. That's in 1 year. That was the most amount of work I ever.
So what'd you do?
Next to maybe Untold History, which is another story, but that's more of a documentary.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's just astonishing. What's the fastest you've ever made? You were saying W was made in...
It's not fast. It's a question of getting it right. I screwed up, too, by doing it. W was made in 50-some days. It was a complicated little movie. But the editing had to be done... Oh, I remember. It was a bad decision. The distributor needed it, wanted to make the... made the deal on the condition that it would be ready before the election of November. While Bush was still in office, because his thinking was that after Bush would be irrelevant, he was already unpopular, that he would be irrelevant after November. But I don't think so. I think the movie would have been more successful, because I think he was a dead in the water after the economy tanked in September. Oh. And we came out in October. So it was a disaster for me. We broke even, but the picture never got the traction. But in hindsight, I think it plays well.
You were saying earlier just that one of the reasons W took as long as it is that Richard Dreyfuss can't remember his lines. Is this true?
Well, I think that was an offstage comment.
Oh, was it? I'm sorry. Yeah. Please ignore that remark.
Yeah. No, we worked very fast. No, the fastest we did was U-Turn and Talk Radio. Those were the two fastest we did.
Uh-huh.
But we always worked fast. We never did long films unless there was a really 70 days, I think, on Born on the 4th of July, and 95 on Alexander, because that was three continents. But I am fast, and I try to get it on the script so that when you go out there, you're not experimenting too much, because it's a lot of money to experiment.
Yeah.
So in the middle of this fury of trying to get going, you've got these two projects. The next year, you come out with Wall Street, which is a huge
hit. Yeah.
So tell me, when did you have the idea for Wall Street? What remember getting the notion that this is a movie?
Oh yeah, I remember very vividly. You always remember the moment, you know.
You do.
Those moments, yeah, sure. The intention is all. You know when you're going to... Sometimes you know it's going to be a movie. Sometimes I've developed a lot of things that don't get made. I've worked very hard on, and sometimes you kind of know that it's not going to get made either. So you have to know, you have to feel it. Wall Street came out of the process of being my father's son, and I wanted to do something about... It was very hot. The 1980s, Reagan had deregulated. Wall Street was getting hot in a way that my father wouldn't recognize, because he died in 85. But the concept of honor, the concept of taking care of the client, somehow was vanishing. But I love the mood of the 1950s Wall Street. And if you look closely at the 1980s Wall Street, you will see some of that 1950s Wall Street. It's still in the faces of the older crowd there. And I just love being in those dark offices. And the mood of Wall Street is what I wanted. And I think it was a film we wrote quickly, Stanley Weiser and I, during the editing of Platoon. And we went right away, correct? We went pretty much right away.
You wrote it during the editing?
It was a learning process, because it was the biggest budget I'd ever had, and it was my first studio film. My real studio film. You have to realize that I was working with independents, and I still do. I go back and forth, but I was working for 20th Century Fox, man. Wow. Daryl Zanuck, Tyrone Power, all that stuff, and Gene Tierney. I wanted to go back into that world. I was in love with Hollywood at that point. The glamour, the surface of Hollywood. Mm. I love, just having actors, seeing actors, talking to a Burt Lancaster about maybe being in the movie, or that was just part of that newness,
I thought I could see it, moment. Especially in the second Wall Street. Some of the scenes, some of the set shots are absolutely beautiful and reminded me of that era.
Well, Second Wall Street is 2008, so we jumped 20 years, and I was shocked because after I did one, I thought it was over. I thought this was a boom. This was a false boom that would bust. And it did briefly in 87 at the crash, but it did bounce back. And during all the 90s, they kept going. These bankers kept... The Gordon Geckos became the bankers. That's what shocks me, because Gecko was an independent operator, mm-hmm. Kind of like an oil wildcatter. Mm-hmm. And there was more and more of them. But by 2008, those guys were running the banks, were the banks. So it's... Wall Street... That's why we had to go back, because we had to see. But that's a different style. The 80s style is a different feel to the film. Not only the old cell phones and stuff, but it was a very advanced film at that time. If you remember the cars, the motorcycle, everything was done with an eye towards modernity, right. Including the decoration at Charlie Sheen's apartment. I called it the demolished look. Which was very much in the vogue then. Yeah. But everything changes, you see. My father was a man who believed that business has to be business. It had to move on. It has to... At the same time, he was a victim of it. Sandy Weill bought his company.
Oh, really?
He worked for a company that was bought by Sandy Weill. Sandy Weill was one of the original monsters who actually put together all these brokerage houses, insurance companies, yeah. Travel companies, and whatever, into financial giants that eventually became Citicorp. And... he knows it. He actually came out about a year ago, and he wrote a kind of a retraction of. But at that time, he was a god. He was a god. Anyway, the point is, my dad went. He always talked about a regulated, reasonable capitalism, but my God, he got crushed in that new capitalism.
Does commercial success matter to you?
It matters to them, and I think it matters to us. If you have people, more people go. You feel better about it, about what you did, and you feel appreciated. However, I really do believe that every good film box office success is often the result of a misunderstanding between the filmmaker and the audience. I think Platoon was perhaps my biggest grossing film, and I think it was misunderstood in the sense that people were wanting to heap praise on the American soldier, and we're ignoring some of the underlying facts in the film about the negativity towards the situation that some of the soldiers felt, the division, the civil war in the platoon, and above all, some of the treatment that was handed out to the Vietnamese. That was put aside. But it was very much a part of what I'd seen. So Platoon could be embraced by, I suppose, right and left, but essentially most movies make their money in the middle. I have made a lot of money by any standard, and by the same rules of capitalism, I have lost a lot of money. So I want to make the point that not just in taxes and divorces, but and children, the curse of Hollywood children is that you have to pay them to go to school. Also in faulty business ventures. I tried, nothing worse. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. I must have invested in 3 or 4 medical companies that were trying to break through on various big issues. And I invested in them, and I lost in 3 of those occasions because the patent situation, the FDA situation, is so highly regulated in this country, mm-hmm. and so difficult. Even if you make something good, and this is a problem for all of us. It's so much, even if you make something good, you can make a patent and you can do all that, but these corporations, they wallpaper everything else around that patent. And it's very difficult for small medical breakthroughs, genius doctors to break through. So I got killed, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And I lost a lot of money.
You know, I've always wanted to ask somebody like you, it's a slightly indelicate question, but I figure if anybody's going to answer it, you'll answer it. Have you ever figured out how much money you made off, say, Platoon? Dollar value, dollar figure?
I never, because we get residuals over the years, so I've never done that count, but I did get I settled because John Daly, the man who made the film, I loved him, but he was a thief. And he was a pirate. And that's the way, you know, you knew it going in. He had more loss. He went out of business eventually in 94, I think, or, you know, no, 89 or 90. He made Last Emperor right after us, the year after, and that was his high. Platoon and Last Emperor, 2 years in a row, best picture. There's nobody from London who couldn't read. I mean, basically, he was a boxing promoter. It was a great story. And instead of becoming Harvey Weinstein, he got buried in lawsuits and went out of business. And he died about 2 years, 3 years ago. I saw him before he died, because I always stayed friendly with him. I loved him. He was a tough guy, and he just never, he had a problem paying. You know, it was just, so did Harvey, but they all do. But they, he's got a problem paying. So he ended up with 55, 100 lawsuits. People were suing him left and right. So I knew, I liked John. I didn't want to get in a lawsuit with him. So we made a settlement. I took less than what I knew I would probably make in a lawsuit. And I just said, fuck it, I just want to, you know, I took that settlement.
So it's hard for you to get paid as well. This
oh,
makes
yeah.
me feel better somehow.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No. The system has gotten even much tighter. Much tighter.
Yeah.
Much tighter.
Now, you...
It's a very, it's a corrupt system, and everyone has written about it and told you, so I'm not going to belabor it, but people have a very false image of directors and... Actors are the highest paid for the amount of work and time they put in, but there's so few of them that make it to a high level, unfortunately, that most of the middle actors are really killed in this business, killed. And they've been killed more because of the high prices paid to the big actors, so it becomes the select, very few club. And maybe movies were always that, I don't know. It seems that it's unfair to the technicians, too, and the people who do so much work. Their salaries have been very flat for a long time. Mm.
Now, you are also an actor. You have cameos in, I think, all of your films. Do you like the... And you've won Academy Awards for many actors.
Not as an actor.
Not as an actor, but as a director. Do you like that process of bringing performances?
Oh, I love it, yeah. It's equally... That's what I love about directing. It's this melange of writing, which is very alone, very interior. And then you take it to this exterior place where you're working with actors in a completely different world, which they have to make it work for themselves. So whatever you've done, that no matter how good it is on paper, you have to find that sweet spot with the person who you may often detest, or he may detest you, but you've worked together in that way that these things happen.
Well, give me a couple of details.
Well, we'll go back to that, but sorry. I want to say there's another side to directing, which is working with the crew, the right. technician. They call them the crew because, like, they're pirate crew. Maybe it is, but the technicians are very sensitive people, and they're all different. That's what I love. There's about 15, 20 keys who do work in costuming, in production design, in camera, in sound, in mixing, in post. In pre, in location. Every one of these things requires their own touch. So it really is a challenge. And I suppose I like the solitariness of being the co-writer or writer. And I love the mix of coming out in public and doing this broad, trying to get it across to so many people. I mean, let's say by the end of the process, 200 to 300 are involved heavily in a deep way, and 1,000 in less so. Mm-hmm. So as to who I detest when...
No, well, my first question was which actors
I would never tell you.
I would never tell you. The second question is, which ones did you detest?
No, I would never tell you that. But the truth is that, you know, it is a social bullshit business. I mean, it's a cocktail party to a certain degree. I mean, you come to a thing where you have to mix. You have to mix. And certain people are not very good at that. I think I'm pretty good at it, personally, but some people may not agree. But I think you have to mix, you have to be gentle, you have to be, at the same time, a bit of a sergeant, where you have to get people to work. At the same time, you have to, it's a creative process, so it's good planning, very good planning. I've always planned my pictures with my producer. I mean, really planned. It's how you see the one-liner, how you schedule these things, when you shoot them. Because things go wrong, but readjusting your plan in the field of action is a general's job, and it's so exciting to me. It's one of the highlights of it is to if you can structure it and it comes out at 54 days and you budget it at 54 days, and you're happy with what you got, that's a miracle. It really is, because it very rarely can you. On Savages, we had a tough budget.
Savages, by the way, is a fantastic film. It's one of my favorites of yours. It really is a great, great
Different, but 2012, And we had a tough budget, what they call medium budget in Hollywood, and it had to work because we were in, my partner and I were in for the completion. We were first ones up, in fact. I think we were 100% with a no deductible for the first $1 million or so over budget. Right. Universal had a tough policy on that. And we had a tough maze-like schedule in the summer of Los Angeles, Laguna Beach, canyons, the heat, and getting in and out of those little houses. We had no stages to fall back on. It was all location. You can't believe how hard it is to get around Los Angeles with trucks. Everyone's very savvy. They charge you a fortune for everything. And there's so many rules and regulations. It's worse than the EPA. So it was like Canada, maybe. I don't know. So we made the picture, and we made it to the day, and we came in like $300,000-$400,000 under after the whole process. So I was very proud of that. And Universal executives told me, quote unquote, Oliver, we have not had one director on this lot in 10, 15 years since we started who ever told us the truth. I said, oh, you're the first. And I said, this is terrible news because it means I'm going to get in trouble now. And sure enough, they dumped me in the wrong slot. They dumped us into July 4th. I said, great. Yeah. I should never have done that. We should have stuck to our October date. Hmm.
There was a scene in the clip that we showed before of Tom Cruise in Born on the 4th of July. He's lying in the rotatable bed. He's upside down. He's saying, I was a Vietnam veteran. Do you recall how many takes you did of that shot?
That was a tough scene. That hospital was very tough. It was a hospital in Dallas, Texas. It was an old hospital. It was broken down, dirty as hell. We renovated. It was already dirty. The Bronx hospital that Ron was in was filthy, so it wasn't too much of a stretch. But those scenes were very tough. Going to work in the morning, I did not relish that. The lighting was hard. The storyline was very tough. Tom Cruise broke through in that scene. That's where he really, because we did those before he went to Vietnam. We went to Philippines. He reached a personal. I felt that Tom had been a young man before that movie, but in some ways, after that role and those moments, I think that he went to another age. There was another ring around his tree, you know.
I want to talk about JFK, if you don't mind. So this is 1991. You've said in the past you think it's your best film. Do you still think so?
No, I didn't say that.
I said
it was the most ambitious. Never said what was my best film.
Oh, you've never said that? Oh.
Never.
All right, my apologies.
And if you can pull the quote, I'd love to see it.
Well, I can't at the moment, but I'll go and find it. I'll go and find it.
No, because I've been very punctilious about that, and I think it's at most ambitious until Untold History, and I've said that Untold History of the United States, although it's a documentary, was the most ambitious project I ever undertook.
So JFK comes out, and literally all hell breaks loose. You're accused of inaccuracy, you're accused of playing with history, you're accused of being unpatriotic, the theory is completely... Did that rock you? I mean, that must have been the biggest reaction.
Yeah, totally,
you've had.
Totally. To go back to the curve I was describing, I had, you know, Wall Street was, I was naive, and it was the first studio film, and the critics did not like it. And it did okay business, but it lasted. It lasted. And I was hurt with that. I mean, the reviews were pretty bad. They were pretty mean, you know, because I had won the Oscar. So I think there was something about, you know, getting even, or who was this guy? So forth and so on. So anyway, talk radio was also viciously received and died a miserable death. So Born on the 4th of July was well received by critics for the most part and by audience, but not as successful as Platoon because the boy was wounded, so it was castrated in the war this way. I mean, we used to see the young people, young girls especially, and young boys would leave the theater after. They would not last for the second half of the movie. They didn't want to see it. It was not a date movie for them.
No.
So we didn't do the same business, but we did very well.
Yeah. And The Doors had done pretty well, hadn't it?
Oh, I forgot. The Doors was after that. No, The Doors was right after that. But Born led to... I got an Oscar, yes.
Yeah.
But it was heartbreaking because Cruise didn't win and Kovic didn't win. So it was
So you care about the Oscars?
At that time I did. It was socially, It was criticized for being left. It was criticized for being like a Stanley Kramer picture, which I like Stanley Kramer. I don't think it is like that kind of picture. It was very radically shot with a Panavision camera, with an anamorphic lens. We did amazing stuff that had never been done before in film with that kind of movement, with anamorphic, which is that 2:3:5 ratio. Mm. So anyway, in other words, it had not been an easy go. So The Doors was also mixed, critical, bad. People liked it. It's like Wall Street. It was that kind of reception where it just goes on. The Doors still plays today. But it was an homage to an era, an excess.
Does Ray Manzarek still hate it?
Oh, hate it.
Ray Manzarek was the keyboard player for The Doors.
You love the negative, but you know he was one of the negatives. But put it this way, I think Jim Morrison liked it. and the JFK was done like in a burst again of innocence too. Like, why doesn't anyone ever talk about? I had believed that the man had been killed by Lee Harvey Oswald. Everyone did, except for those people who read anything. But you know, we just went with it. I'd never thought about it until I kept meeting people who were bringing these subjects up, all kinds of. What did you ever think about this or this, this, this? And the 70s had been the 70s. So this lunatic lady gave me a book in the elevator in Havana. Ellen Ray, she was a publisher of the book. And she was a real confirmed leftist. And she represented Jim Garrison. And it was his book, his last one. It was a beautiful book, beautiful read. Tension was enormous. And I met Garrison. And I fell into this idea, like, let's go. Let's do it. Let's bring out some of these things because you don't hear them. And I did it in a sort of innocence, I suppose. And it'd be very hard to go back there, knowing what I know. The attacks devastated me, hurt me. It was continual, and it was all major media establishment, always. People who attacked me didn't know me, whether it was Richard Nixon, George Bush, Henry Kissinger, Walter Cronkite, every newsman. Horrible things were written, and like I'd falsified it. We did fight back. Frank Mankiewicz, who'd worked with Robert Kennedy, worked with us with the PR. We fought back hard. We tried to answer articles. I chased the movie for 6 to 9 months. And I know, I don't think I ever was the same. I don't think I would ever, I would be ridiculed by the media and marginalized over the years, but I kept working. I had no choice. I believe in what I believe. I couldn't back down. I did movie after movie, but never with the same reception of warmth that I'd had with Platoon and Born on the 4th of July.
So this is my question to you. So, and you're now you're used to this. I mean, you're getting a lot of blowback.
I'm way past it, yeah.
Yeah, but you're getting a lot of blowback as well on the untold history of the United States. So my question is, I mean, you know, I get an ugly email for a story I've written, and I have to take to my bed. But how do you, and as you've said, you're sensitive about this. Some of your producers have said you're sensitive to criticism because you take risks. How do you, what do you tell yourself that says, okay, Stone, up, go into it again? Because you keep going into it. I mean, you're a slow learner.
Yeah, Gore Vidal once said to me, you know, Gore was not the nicest of men. He prided himself on not liking people, but he had a tolerance for me. And we had at one dinner, he said, Stone, something wrong with you? Do you have a steel plate in your head? I never forget that. It just came out of the blue, you know? And I keep thinking about where I do have a steel plate in my head, and maybe I was shot and I didn't know it. You know, there's something that set in early because I was an only child that I would keep going and do what I was going to do. And you got to set your course, you know, and if you believe something, you believe it. That's not to say you don't listen to the opposition. I did read the criticisms of all these films up to a point. I mean, I got it. I mean, Arthur Schlesinger and I were arguing on the stage. Schlesinger was, in my opinion, the orthodox Cold War liberal. Mm-hmm. And my point of view is, frankly, I think I'm a radical liberal by their standards, but I think I'm pure. And I think that there are a lot of people like me, a lot. I know that because I get also positive mail about keep it up. Mm-hmm. And the history, by the way, was well received. 1.1 million viewers a week averaged on that series, a documentary series of that thickness and depth, without much advertising from Showtime, was quite a victory for us.
Yeah.
And they were very happy with it, so it's being repeated, and eventually will come out on DVD in September, October. But I'm past it. I didn't read the reviews on history this time. Peter would send me the concept issues, like, okay, Sean Willens is raising this issue and this issue. Yeah, that's different. But I can't read the television reviews were not good.
No.
Because we're out of the box. I mean, we're a 10-hour history of the United States, which we don't agree with anything that's conventionally thought of and taught in school. You're in trouble, you know. Forget it. You can't even be it. But on the contrary, I'm very proud of the fact that we were ready to take the sweep and, you know, no compromises. No compromises on history. No compromises on the atomic bomb. Take no prisoners attitude that the right, Republican right, has taught us since the 1980s, to some degree applies. I don't think we have to be as crude. I think we have to be intelligent. But they're playing for real power politics. I think that they rig the electoral votes when they can. I think they will do anything to get power. And it's all about power. Mm-hmm. And people like me are marginal because I'd like to be running for office and all that, but I it's impossible in our system. And we'll get into that in your question and answer, because America has concentricized down to this a place where there's a bipartisan foreign policy and a bipartisan media. Mm-hmm.
I have so many questions, and I have about 10 minutes left, I think. You made history with that movie, JFK. You testified before the Senate. They brought in a new act that declassified a lot of documents. Quickly, now that you know what you know, now that all this new stuff has come out, what's your theory on who killed JFK now?
Whoa, if I said it, I'd be in trouble. I think it would make it be bleeped someplace. It'd be tweeted.
Not in Canada, it wouldn't. Not in Alberta.
The Assassinations Record Review Board Collection Act, was 92 after the movie came out. It was done in opposition to the film to show that they were clean in Congress. And they intended to do so, and we knew that there'd be no smoking gun. These things don't get written down the way you think it's going to get written down. But what they didn't realize was that when they released, 25 million pages or whatever it was, somebody would tell you in the crowd, I'm sure, so much pages, all these experts got in there and started to find all this stuff, little stuff. But if you start to piece it together, it does add up. So we got an enormous amount of detail, including things like Operation Northwoods, which was a plan turned down by Kennedy, by the way, that was by the Pentagon to provoke incidents like 9/11 on our soil to justify an invasion of Cuba. That's very interesting. Operation Dirty Hook, one of the original operations in Vietnam was revealed. So was Doug Horne wrote a 5-volume, amazing, about their work in 92, 95. They ran out of money and they had to stop. But it's the Assassination Review Board, 5 volumes, Doug Horne. And some of that work is seeped into the literature with James Douglas's Kennedy and the Unspeakable, which is a terrific read. He's a beautiful writer, James Douglas, Kennedy and the Unspeakable, Brothers by David Talbot. And new stuff keeps coming out. I get all the fringe details, and I love it. I still read up on it. I know more about Oswald than I did than ever. I mean, the guy is the jigsaw man. He's amazing. Yeah. So who did it? I still believe, as I said then, that it had to be done at a high level, because there's just no way to have corralled all these forces that were at work that day. And there were forces that were so many sloppy. The Warren Commission is absurd. I mean, there's so many witnesses, so many different tales of people being there that day. And I talked to a lot of those people. The only way to add it up coherently is that it's a classic black ops operation. And if the details, how that works, I could get into more detail in the question and answer, but I don't want to do that right now. It had to come from a high level, and I have an idea who, but I can't say. But I think David Talbot, who I know, is working on an interesting thesis. I hope he gets there. And I think that book will be out in the fall.
All right. Oh, good. We'll get him here. Two last things. Have you ever heard, you make a movie, W, about the president while he's in office.
Yeah.
You have a picture of him. One shot, he's on the toilet answering questions. I mean, it's not polite. And I don't want to spoil it for you. It's a fantastic movie. Have you ever heard from George Bush about it? Or any of those goons? I mean, has Wolfowitz called you and said, you know, really, I'm handsomer than that, or anything like that?
No. But by way of compliments, Clinton did see it and told me that he sent the DVD over to Bush. Clinton loved it. He did. He said you got it, you know. And he thinks, I had the feeling from the, he didn't tell me exactly what George said, but he did imply that George had congratulated, was good-natured about it. That's what I got from Clinton, that George had said that Josh Brolin was very good. And actually, I was criticized for making him too empathetic. And two, he was amused by it, but I don't think he would have liked the film because I think it's a tough on him, too. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of pain there, a lot of pain. An inability to communicate, an inability to understand himself. Something's wrong and you don't know what's wrong. It's kind of like the classic disease of the person who doesn't know what's wrong. That's where you lack consciousness.
Right.
That's why I found him fascinating as a two-dimensional man. And I always said that Nixon, to me, was a three-dimensional man in my movie, much more self-aware of who Nixon is, loathing him nonetheless. Mm-hmm. Whereas Bush doesn't seem to be puzzled, why do they hate me so?
Mm-hmm. He's unconscious, as you say, yeah.
Right. So the other person who commented on the film through a friend, I would never have talked to her in person about it because she never would have talked to me, was Nancy Reagan, who at a dinner party said, he nailed that guy.
Mm. Oh, good.
He said, it was great, she said. So Nancy Reagan was a fan. I think a lot of the right-wingers might be.
Yeah, just secretly liking it quite a lot?
Yeah, I do. I do. I think the film is enjoyable on many levels. I'm very proud of that movie.
As opposed to
got a lousy distribution. I've had some lousy marketing campaigns, you know.
You once said that nationalism or you had somebody in a movie say, that nationalism and patriotism, or maybe you said it, are the real enemies, especially in a war. You've been critical to some degree of, what did Tom Brokaw call them, the greatest generation? You've said that they created the Cold War, they didn't have to, they sort of sold us out. I have two questions. What do you think of our generation, you know, the boomers? Yeah, the 60s generation. I mean, how do you think we've done? And what do you think of this next generation?
So those are broad questions, you know. Now, the reason I was critical of the World War II generation, I want to put this in the right context, is that, you know, look, they fought, what they did in Europe and Japan in the war was quite good, quite amazing. And they fought a very tough war in both places. And they took, what I did not like was a hucksterism that kicked in. After the Soviet Empire fell in 91, we had no enemy. We created enemies. We went into Panama within a month of the Berlin Wall falling to capture a drug kingpin who was now declared enemy number one, Noriega. A year later, we were into Iraq, Kuwait. We went into Kuwait because Saddam Hussein, our ex-ally CIA guy, was now our declared enemy number one, danger to the world. He was a new Adolf Hitler, per George Bush, the father. He was Adolf Hitler. He was compared constantly to Hitler. So here we go again. And if you look closely at Stephen Ambrose's book, D-Day, The Climactic Battle of World War II, which it is not. It's an important battle, but it's not hardly the climactic battle. The climactic battle was on the Russian front. And it was Stalingrad or Kursk, and or Kursk. Ambrose's book, the triumphalism of Brokaw's American, Greatest Generation, the rediscovery of World War II people, in line with George Bush Sr., George Bush, the father, had been a fighter pilot in the Pacific. And then came Spielberg's movie, Saving Private Ryan, which is an amazing opening sequence, beautifully done, but the rest of the movie is absolute horseshit. And it's just, again, about sacrifice and about American soldiers being, there's no allies in the film, there's no Canadians, there's no British, there's nobody else, but no Poles, by the way. It's just Americans, and they're all dying for each other. I mean, I was in the infantry. We would have killed, we would have shot Tom Hanks by reel two because we realized what a, you know, he's leading us into hell, and we're not gonna die for this guy. We're not gonna die for this stupid mission, which never took place, by the way. The brothers existed, the four brothers existed. I don't wanna get too much detail. That's a Q&A thing, but these are crucial moments in the national psyche of America. It leads so clearly to this war mentality that Bush brought in. In 2000, Gladiator was Best Picture. And I did this in the series. I cut to the films. In 2001, in December, one of the most acclaimed films of that year, right after the 9/11, was Black Hawk Down, which is, a loathsome picture about Americans dying in Somalia. A few of them die, but of course they kill 900 or 1,000 black people who are running around shooting at them. And it's totally irrelevant. It's exaggerated beyond belief. And every soldier dies heroically, every American soldier. It was disgusting, loathsome, nauseous to me. And I saw this coming when 2002, and Bush puts his foot to the pedal and wants to go to war. And all these liberals again, the New York Times, the Washington Post, all these liberals joining in and saying, yeah, it's a good idea. Tom Friedman, these guys saying, let's go to war. That we can shake up the Middle East. We'll get rid of a tyrant, and then not only that, we're going to shake up the place and bring them, quote, freedom and democracy. That, it all comes out of American exceptionalism, which comes out of that mentality that you saw in the 90s, starting with the Greatest Generation.
It comes out of a flaw, a hole in the society, or is it a human flaw? Is it a? Is it a tragedy is it a scandal?
It is a tragedy. Because we have to feel good about ourselves. We have to look in the mirror and feel self-love. But when you're denying all the facts and you're not listening to the other side of the people that you were killing in Vietnam or Iraq or Afghanistan or Central America, when you don't know and you don't care about them, then you lack compassion, you lack empathy, and you're not even interested in finding out. So we have had the bomb since 1945, the atomic bomb. That was a very important moment, and we go into detail on that. It need not have been used. It was strategically unnecessary, and we go into detail on that. When the bomb was dropped, it gave us an inordinate power that we were right because we were good. The sense that we were right because we were good, and we were good because we were right. We invented our own code of morality from that moment on. And that was the opening shot of the Cold War. And I think you have to start with that. The Cold War did not start after Germany fell. The Cold War started, accelerated with that bomb. My generation, we lived in the middle of this, and those people unfortunate enough to go to Vietnam realized that we did nothing about it. We couldn't. We were fighting in the wrong cause. Mm-hmm. It was a stagnant. We were now the oppressor of poor peoples all around the world, and we were going into situations all in the military, constantly on the wrong side of history. So what chance did we have to be, we were never going to be liberators. We were always going to be, they called themselves liberators, but we destroyed Baghdad and most of Iraq. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I don't know that I can give you the answer. I think many of us in our generation turned to internal answers. We lived through the 60s, 70s. We saw the idealism. We felt it. Mm-hmm. We felt in 1970, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that things were going to change. When Carter was elected in 76, it was a beacon. It was like a new beginning. We thought Carter was going to change the world. Mm-hmm. And he promised to, but he, like Obama, he was unable to deliver.
Oh, now don't start on Obama.
Okay, no, I won't. Yeah. But I'm just saying, I'm talking about our generation now. So yeah. We ended up in this morass of every president has put us in check. We've been in check. And our generation has been, so I think we turned to internal, like I turned to films, and some people turned to spiritual life. There's all kinds of new, and some people turned to money, let's face it. A lot of young people my age made a fortune on Wall Street. Mm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, somebody asked him about Obama and about the next generation. We've come to the end of the formal part of this. Thank you very much. You've been most frank and
thank you.
Wanted to thank you, Ian, for your insightful questions.
No.
And to Oliver for your incredible courage through your career and your willingness to be transparent about the creative process and your professional and personal journey tonight. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
So I'll take the tall guy over here with our blue mic.
How's it going, Oliver? I'm a huge fan of your films. I love JFK. It inspired me to become a filmmaker. But the question I have is, with the escalation of gun violence in America, and especially all these directors coming under attack for making these violent-toned films, what are your thoughts on that? And also, with President Barack Obama's proposals, do you think it's going to solve anything? Do you think it's going to tone down the gun violence?
Certainly a broad question. In my own work, I've tried to be very realistic about violence, except on one occasion. If you look at Platoon, Salvador, born on the 4th of July, one bullet, look at the damage it does in the movie. He's paralyzed the rest of his life. I mean, if anything, it was too disturbing for most people. Real violence is really disturbing in movies for real people. They want fantasy violence. They really do. It works better. Go through a wall, kill many bad guys, don't even get wounded. I mean, that really does work. It's a magic formula. So people have some fantasy aspect in their mind where they're willing to go there and love it. And America has always been violent. Violent culture, violent films, vigilante films. Clint Eastwood started with the Dirty Harrys, and he made his fame and fortune. Schwarzenegger, Norris, Stallone. You can never underestimate a gun and a girl in your hand. You always do well. Not always, but that is always the American way, two-fisted. It's a shame, because we've lost track of we've become morally blind, so that by the time Zero Dark 30 comes out, people shrug, okay, we killed Bin Laden. No one ever, in the media anyway, seems to stop and think that we didn't do that in the old days. We didn't have extrajudicial executions before 9/11. Israel did, and we condemned them for those missions. Where they would go to a foreign country and kill somebody, because it sets the wrong example. You may succeed on the short term, but you do lose in the long term, because it sets a horrible example of lawlessness. And we, the issue of torture is, I don't know if we're going to have to argue about that, but it's horribly, it doesn't work, and I'm totally against it, and I saw it myself. We used to waterboard people in Vietnam. It's bullshit. People do not give you good information. But aside from that, the issue is, why did they just go there and kill him? He was wounded. If we'd had real guts, we would, like the guys who were in the World War II generation, like Telford Taylor and Jackson, those people, we would have taken him, put him on the helicopter, brought him and put him on trial in New York City. And it would have been a wonderful moment for the country. It would have been painful as hell. It would have been like allowing Adolf Hitler to speak at his own trial, which I wish we had, because you would have seen the man. He would have been, frankly, I think, diminished, although he had his message. And it's clear that the United States did not belong in the Middle East, and that was what it was about. His message would have been clear, and people may have understood in our country why 9/11 happened, because I think a large majority of them still don't get it. And if you remember correctly, Bush and Obama now has signed on to the lie that 9/11 is linked to Iraq, which it never was. So, my answer to my only film I ever made, which was a satire, that is to say a reversal of that process, was Natural Born Killers, where I did go, and U-Turn also, and to some degree Savages, but I did go to the extremes on Natural Born. The violence in that, there was not one killing that is real or believable to me. It was done as a cartoon, as a satire. People made fun of me calling it a satire. They said, it's not a satire. You know, to me it was, because it's excessive. And excess, when it turns in on itself, it's supposed to show the audience, allow it to laugh, at the same time to be horrified, and to see that's my culture. That was the time we did that movie, at the time of O.J. Simpson, which, by the way, completely occupied and subsumed the American public. It was a huge operation. It was like a war. O.J. Simpson, that was the end of us. That was the end of us. It was so silly that I think the television industry made billions of dollars selling advertising and the news programs all the time for an act of violence that was exalted into a soap opera. We lost our way. The satire, though, you see, we lost our way, but not in movies only. If you look at the American political culture of the last 70 years since World War II, that is the satire. That is the biggest satire of all. All you have to do is go back to Kubrick's Dr. Strangelove, which is now acceptable as a classic film, but it was not when it came out. It was considered raw, stupid, ugly, and meant by many people. But it is a satire of the American military thinking. And what you saw in that film has only gotten worse by tens.
100 years from now, for some reason, we're all still alive. We have a whole new generation or set of generations of folks. What would be the first film that you would want people to see 100 years from now? What might be the last one? And if you're only allowed to have time for one more film, what would the subject be?
I have no one film, no favorite film. I've been asked 100 times. Can you ask me? Ask a legitimate question. Go to part two, please.
It's really about messaging. And there was a wonderful quotation at the beginning. It was about if we are survivors, we have a sacred honor of passing on. For others.
Yes.
So it's really from that perspective. It's not at all a trite sort of thing. It's not what you're most proud of, what's your favorite. Perhaps what's most important to you.
Oh, yeah.
You mentioned cerebral and visceral. Just your thoughts on that.
You listen to me. That's great. There's a lot of truth in that. As to my story, which you seem to know a little bit about, thank you for being, that is a legitimate question, and that is a true feeling. At the end of Platoon, it was Charlie Sheen said something like that. We have an obligation to those who died to remember. And that's what Veterans Day and all these days are for. All these people who want to go to war, the Cheneys and I forgot their names, all those thugs, never went to war. They were chicken hawks. Those who go have a fundamental obligation to remember not only their comrades, but who they killed, and the people, the civilians who were killed. And it is a journey. And all my life, when I've had many bad periods when I probably have not lived up to that, but I am trying to. And making this untold history is a culmination for me of all the dramatic themes, but brought home now into one factual 12-hour documentary. So in a way, it wiped me out. I mean, this last 5 years doing this was my debt to that generation, my time. I wish it could be seen by everybody in every high school. I'm going to try, and I'm going to go on with the rest of my life talking to students, going to high schools, sometimes talking to smaller crowds sometimes. You have to keep fighting. That message, that film will live forever. That's all I can say. It's wider, it's easier access than a book. The book is 800 pages, so it's harder to read, but it's a reference guide. But the movie is my heart. That's done with poetry. I don't know that I could do better. So if I've done anything, that's my message. In my remaining years, I would like to still be a witness and still fight. I don't know that I could get together the ammunition to fight at this level of a big thing like this, because you need financing, and they're always after me now. Yeah, it's like they see me before I come. It's not fair, because if they see savages coming, they hate it because it's not what they expect. And that is a problem when you have a definition and a personality. You have to be that personality. But I've always avoided it, and I try not to read as much as I used to. I don't read the newspapers anymore. I'm sorry, I'm giving that up. Can't take it anymore. It's the same thing over and over again, and I've reached an age when I get tired of it. But friends tell me, I read the specialized pieces, like Victoria Collier wrote a great piece in October of last year for Harper's Magazine on the fixing of American elections, which was shocking. Good pieces take time. You can't live in the tyranny of now. You can't live in today's news. Something happens in Mali and they all go crazy again, or Libya. You got to look at the patterns, the causes, and the effects. So I'm reading as deep as I can right now. And I read good people, but I read far less. But I hope to God I can do some good work still. I really do. Thank you.